And welcome to Rekindled Church. We're so glad you decided to join us online today. But if you would like to meet with us in person, just go to the Parks and Recreation Center of Albemarle at 11 a.m. Listen, we would love to see you there. And I hope you enjoy our service this morning as we continue our series through the Gospel of John.
My sin was before me, I was swallowed by pride. But out of the darkness you brought me to your light. You showed me new mercy and opened up my eyes. From the day you saved my soul,
you were
Time. So if you would, please take your Bibles and turn with me to John chapter 4. John chapter 4. Now, did you know that people will pretty much believe anything? For instance, the percentage of Americans who believe that Elvis is still alive is 10%. People who believe in reincarnation, over 30%. People who believe in ghosts, 39%. That aliens have visited the earth in the past 100 years, 53%. That the U.S. government is currently involved in cover-ups and conspiracies, 74%. People will believe anything, but will stop short of believing the most important thing. People will accept all kinds of theories and beliefs, but they won't accept what the Bible says about Jesus Christ. The fact is, people seem to be jaded. Our text today presents to us a woman who is jaded at a well. She has been around and around riding the merry-go-round of life, and she's worn out from it. But one day, Jesus Christ showed up outside her little town. She meets him and opens her eyes to the fact that there is a new life, a life that is free from the burdens and problems of the life she is now living. Jesus takes this jaded, hardened woman and leads her to a place of realization. I guess you could say that Jesus gives her a reality check. Maybe you are here this morning, you have grown world weary. Maybe you are sick of walking the treadmill of life day in and day out. You're tired of the way things are and you want to change. Listen, this passage is all about how that can be the reality in your life. Let's take a few minutes this morning to examine John chapter 4. We're going to be in verses 1 through 26. It is in this passage we will examine the realization of living water. The realization of living water. First, we must recognize the circumstances of living water. So if you have your place in John chapter 4, beginning verse 1. Now when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had learned that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only his disciples, he left Judea and departed again for Galilee. And he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, so Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. Verse 7. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria?" For the Jews had no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that's saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us this well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true." Verse 19, the woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshiper will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him." Verse 24, "God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." The woman said to him, "I know that the Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things." Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." My friends, we must realize the circumstances of living water. First, we must examine the religious position. In John chapter 4, 1 through 2, he said, "Now when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only his disciples," the text tells us that the Pharisees were angered by the growing popularity of Jesus. Our text tells us that Jesus was baptizing more disciples than John. Both John the Baptist and Jesus taught repentance. Baptism was an expression of new life. It was an outward expression of a repentant heart. John and Jesus both were preaching about the coming of the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God was to begin in the hearts of men. Not only were the Pharisees suspicious of Jesus, but if we recall, John's disciples were also concerned. They viewed Jesus as someone who was stealing crowds from John the Baptist. In John chapter 3, John told his disciples, "I must decrease and he must increase." John knew that his job was to proclaim that the Messiah was coming. However, the biggest observation we can take from this text is that Christ left the religious followers in Judea and went to Galilee. Our text says that now when Jesus learned, now some translate the word learned as heard, and some translate the word as knew. The best translation of the text is knew. He knew. The better word is that the commentator A.W. Pink suggests that this points to the omniscience of Christ. After all, there is no indication anywhere in our text that someone informed Christ of the situation. How did he know about it?
He's God. He knows. Jesus left because he knew men's hearts. John 2:24 says, but Jesus would not entrust himself to them, for he knew all men. He did not need man's testimony about man, for he knew what was in man. Jesus knew the religious hearts of the Pharisees. Religious self-righteousness keeps people from accepting the truth of the gospel. Instead of causing a confrontation between the Jewish leaders, Christ left them in Judea and pursued those who wanted to hear the good news of the gospel. Not only do we see the religious circumstances, but we also see the sovereign circumstances. Nothing takes God by surprise. Jesus knows the hearts of men. In verses 3 through 4, we read, he left Judea and departed again for Galilee, and he had to pass through Samaria. He had to pass through Samaria. Jesus said, in fact, some translations say he must pass through Samaria. Throughout John's writing, he used the verb had to. All through the Gospel of John, you're going to see he had to. This verb referred to Jesus' sovereign knowledge. In other words, there was a divine appointment awaiting him. This decision to go to Samaria was not done by random choice, but it was the sovereign choice of God. What does the Bible tell us about the Samaritans? While the Jews were under Babylonian captivity, they intermarried with the Syrians. The Jews looked at Samaritans as half-breed race that was unclean or unfit. They hated the Samaritans so much that they would go completely around Samaria in order to go to the Sea of Galilee. In order to go to Jerusalem, there were two other paths that were much longer to get there. They would rather go around the city than go through it, the city's people. In other words, they could take their money. However, this did not mean that the Jews could not do business with the Samaritans, but they could not eat or drink with a Samaritan, and they could not be friends with a Samaritan. In other words, they could take their money, but that was it. Both sides of their family tree wanted nothing to do with them. The Assyrians didn't want anything to do with them. The Jews didn't want anything to do with them. They were a race of people without a people. However, we need to notice the location Jesus went to Samaria. In verses 5 through 6, we read, so he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, so Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. Notice where it was. It was in Sychar. Sychar was where the bones of Joseph were buried. In fact, when we look at this location of Jacob's well, there's a lot of history involved in this place. You know, we're talking about living water this morning, right? You go and do research about Jacob's well. And I want to tell you what you're going to find. Every time in Scripture we see this mentioned, everywhere through the Old Testament, there is what they call types in the Bible, imagery in the Bible that always points to a certain event. You know, we talk about, he was in Isaiah, the Bible says that Jesus was bruised for our transgressions. What does that mean? He's pointing toward the cross in the Old Testament. Every time we see Jacob's well mentioned throughout the Scripture, it is in reference to a greater water. It's saying, yes, this water will keep you alive for a little bit, but there's one coming that will help you have eternal life. We look at Abraham. Abraham made his sacrifice to God. Where? At the well. It was where God sat there and said, listen, Abraham, listen, I understand everything that's going on in your life. And he made a covenant with God. And we see that Abraham made a sacrifice to God there. All at Jacob's well. We look all through. In fact, we could take a whole series of sermons just going through the history of nothing but Jacob's well. In fact, we see imagery of the death, burial, and resurrection in Jacob's well. In fact, me and Brad were talking about it Wednesday night at his house. I was showing it to him. I said, isn't this wild? He said, man, that could be an Easter sermon. Yes. My friends, there's imagery, lots of imagery surrounding Jacob's well. And it points to one person, and that person is Jesus Christ. So I think it's very fitting that Jesus shows up in his own imagery. It is Jesus who decides to go to Sychar. Do you know what the word Sychar means? I was reading A.W. Pink, great commentator, and he points out that the word named Sychar means purchased. Means purchased. Oh, my friends, listen to me. I don't think it's any coincidence that this woman at the well who Jesus was going to talk to, that he was ordained to talk to, that he had to go talk to, went to a place called purchased. Because, my friends, what Jesus was telling her is that she has been purchased with a great price. She has been purchased with a great price. Oh, let us not forget. Jesus knew the time and place to meet the Samaritan woman. We see that our text says that she went there on the sixth hour. That Jesus sat by this well at noon during the hottest time of the day. My friends, what we see is that God was sovereign over this situation. He said, I have to go to Samaria. I have to go to Jacob's well. I have to be there. I'm going to be there at this time. I want to be there at this place. And this is where I'm going to meet her. See, the stage was set. Jesus is in the right place at the right time for an encounter in God's will. He was in reality keeping a divine appointment that he himself had made before the foundation of the world. Oh, let's not forget that God still keeps divine appointments. He still keeps divine appointments. R.C. Sproul calls this divine initiative. My friends, we cannot get to God in our own power. We cannot get to him through our own faith and our own goodness. Ephesians chapter 2 says that we are dead in our trespasses and in our sins. What can a dead man do? A dead man can do absolutely nothing for himself. Sinful man cannot initiate a conversation with a holy God. It is God that initiates the conversation with sinful man. He is the one who ordains the time and the place for his divine conversation. Not only do we see the circumstances of living water, but now we see the communication of living water. In verse 7, a woman from Samaria came to draw water. And in verse 6, we've already seen on the sixth hour of the day, which was the hottest time of the day, why did she draw water at the worst time of the day? Why? Why not go in the morning? Why not go in the evening when it's cooler? The answer can be summed up in one word. Shame. Shame. This woman was a person of vile reputation. She went to the well to be left alone. She did not want gossiping eyes staring at her. She would rather be beaten down by the heat than by people. In verse 7, we see that Jesus initiated a conversation with her. He said, "Give me to drink." By this request, Jesus was going against the social norm of the day. First, because she was a Samaritan. Jews did not talk to Samaritans. Second, because men were not to speak to a woman in public, not even their own wives. The fact that Jesus sent his disciples to buy food in Samaria should tell us that Jesus was more concerned with people than the religious customs of the Jews. There was no one more surprised than the woman at the well. She says in verse 9, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman from Samaria?" Notice her shock and attitude in her voice. Notice the attitude of dismay. "I can't believe that a man is talking to me at this well at the noon of the day. What does he want?" Here was Jesus intentionally turning the conversation towards the gospel. Notice what he says in verse 10. "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." Jesus said, "If you knew the gift of God." This woman was not seeking God. She was not pursuing God. If she had been seeking or pursuing God, then she would have recognized Jesus as the gift of God. The woman just saw Jesus as another man who wanted to use her. Her mind was on the physical and not the spiritual. We can see this in her reply in verse 11. It says, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where do you get this living water?" Jesus confronted her with the idea of living water, and it blew her mind. Listen, she is a picture of every person who is not in a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? The Bible says that our sinful condition separates us from God. Isaiah 59:2 says this, "But your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear." What does that mean? It means what a miserable condition to be in. That's what this means. To lack the ability to pray, to worship and fellowship with God is a horrible way to live. Yet many are in that condition today. They pray. They pray, but God doesn't hear. They pray, but God doesn't hear. They go to church to worship, but they cannot worship because they are lost in sin. All the religious activity is merely an exercise of the flesh. It does not reach heaven. It does not touch the Lord. They are lost and they're isolated from God. Oh, my friends, the fact that Jesus confronted this woman at the well is an act of God's grace. This woman had done nothing to deserve a conversation with Jesus, but it was in God's plan to talk to her. The fact that God initiates a conversation with sinful humanity is absolutely astonishing. The fact that God takes time to communicate and confront us is truly amazing grace. It's amazing grace. Not only do we see the communication was confronting, but we also see that it was also curious. In verse 12, we can still see some of the anger and hostility in her voice. She said, "Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us this well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." She basically said this, "Who are you to talk about living water? Who are you to make such an outlandish statement? Are you greater than my ancestor Jacob?" She was thinking even Jacob had to dig a well in order to drink. How can you be better than Jacob? Well, she did not realize that she was standing before the one who wrestled with Jacob. She was talking to the one who changed Jacob's name to Israel. She was talking to the one who spoke the world into existence. She was talking to the very living water. Notice how Jesus replied to her. "Everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks of this water that I will give him shall never thirst. But the water that I will give him will become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life." Why did Jesus choose to use water as an analogy? Why did he do it? Water is a symbol of purity, and it's a symbol of refreshment. Because without water, people will remain dirty and their thirst will never be quenched. Jesus said that those who drink of Jacob's well will thirst again. They'll never be able to wash. They'll get dirty again. They'll have to wash themselves again. They'll have to drink again. In other words, our physical thirst will never end in this life. However, Jesus says, "But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him shall never thirst, but the water that I will become in him, a well of water springing up to eternal life." Notice that Jesus refers to his life-giving water as a well of water springing up to eternal life. See, the term living water was not an uncommon term. It was not an uncommon term. In fact, people use this term when referring to springs or rivers. It referred to any water that moved. Springs and rivers moved with power and strength. Jesus is speaking of his eternal power and strength. Jesus is revealing that he is the source of the living water. He was saying he had the power and the strength to wash her sins away. In verse 15, the woman replies to Jesus, still thinking of physical terms. She says, "Sir, give me the water so I will not be thirsty, nor come all the way here to draw." This woman was so curious about this message of Jesus. She was curious. She thought that if this water could keep her from shame of drawing water every day, if this water could keep her from gossiping stares of other women, then please give it to me. Sign me up. Give me some living water. However, she was still thinking in the physical and not the spiritual. Oh, my friends, Jesus did not verbally attack this woman, but instead he used wisdom in the way he communicated truth to her. Arthur J.C. Ryle brings more insight to this thought. I want to read this quote by him. "So our Lord's conduct in this place should be carefully remembered by all who want to do good and the thoughtless and spiritually ignorant. It is vain to expect that such people will voluntarily come to us and begin to seek knowledge. We must begin with them and go down to them in the spirit of courteous and friendly offense. It is a vain to expect that such people will be prepared for our instruction and will at once seek and acknowledge the wisdom of all we are doing. We must go to work wisely. We must study the best avenues to their hearts and the most likely way of arresting their attention. There is a handle to every mind, and our chief aim must be to get hold of it. Above all, we must be kind in manner. Beware of showing that we feel conscious of our own superiority. If we let ignorant people fancy that we think we are doing them a great favor and talking to them about religion, there is a lot of hope. There is little hope of doing good to their souls. Oh, my friends, in a nutshell, J.C. Ryle is saying this: we are not to be jerks when presenting the gospel. We cannot force feed God's truth to anyone. In fact, if you want to shut down a conversation fast enough, try to force feed somebody the gospel. Not only do we see the circumstances of living water, the communication of living water, but now we see the conviction of living water. There is nothing more powerful than the convicting presence of God. We can see this in the statement that Jesus made to the Samaritan woman. He said in verse 16, "Go call your husband and come here." The woman answered and said, "I have no husband." And Jesus said to her, "You are correctly said, I have no husband. For you have had five husbands, and the one you have now had is not your husband. This you have said truly." The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet." Notice that Jesus said, "Go call your husband and come here." Jesus already presented the woman with the idea of living water. Now he moved the conversation to repentance and salvation. By telling her to go call her husband, Jesus was confronting her with her sin. However, notice how the woman tried to cover up her sin. She simply said, "I have no husband." Now listen, she did not necessarily lie, but she did not tell the whole truth. However, the Lord knows all things, and our attempt to hide our sin will come to no avail. Jesus looked at the woman and said, "You have correctly said, I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one whom you are now living with is not your husband. This you have said truly." We see in our text that Jesus used the woman's half-truth to expose her sin. This may seem cruel of the Lord, but nobody will even come to Jesus for salvation until they first are awakened to their own personal need. Until the sinner knows he is lost, he will never desire to be found. Therefore, conviction is of vital importance. Without it, nobody can ever be saved. My friends, God is not nearly afraid of revealing your sins as you are of having them revealed to you. He will do whatever it takes to bring his children to repentance. Not only do we see the truth of conviction, but we also see the transition of conviction. The truth spoken to the Samaritan woman began to open her eyes to her condition. Notice what he says in verse 19, "I perceive that you are a prophet." Notice that she called Jesus a prophet. You start to see a progression involved in this conversation. She was starting to see that Jesus was not just an ordinary man. When Jesus confronted her with her sin, she did not deny it, but instead she was admitting it. She was saying, "You must be a prophet to know my sin." Now listen, how do you view Jesus this morning? See, our culture is filled with people who view Jesus as just a good man. They believe Jesus is a way, but not the way. As we have examined our text, we see that Jesus is beginning to make clear to the woman that he is the way, the truth, and the life. Notice in this whole framework, he is not giving this woman options. There's only one living water. Now that we have seen the circumstances of living water, the communication of living water, the conviction of living water, we can now examine the Christ of living water. The Christ of living water. First, let's look at the reason for Christ. In verse 20, verse 20 begins with a Samaritan woman asking a question. Our father worshiped in the mountains, and you people say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Notice how her attitude has already changed again. When we talk to Jesus, our attitude can't help but change. Since they are going to the topic of religion, the woman proceeds to show Jesus that she is not a slacker. She tries to start an argument about the proper place to worship. Unfortunately, because of this mixed heritage, the Samaritans combined the Jewish beliefs along with pagan beliefs. She said, our fathers had worshiped in the mountains. They wanted their religion to be all-inclusive. They wanted a little bit of Judaism, they wanted a little bit of paganism, and they wanted to swish it all together, hold hands, and sing kumbaya. She also asked if she needed to worship in Jerusalem. If we examine the Jewish religion at the time, we will see that it was just as empty as the Samaritans. They wanted a Messiah to lead them out of the Roman oppression. They were looking for an earthly king to relieve their present conditions. Their focus was on their religious traditions. Notice how Jesus replied to her, woman, believe me that the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. Jesus simply ignores her attempt to argue and tells her that true worship is never found in external rituals and substitutes for God, but the only true reason for worship can be found in the heart. Now that we have discussed the reason of Christ, let's now discuss the response of Christ. In verse 22, Jesus continues his discussion with the woman. He says, you worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. Jesus was telling her that her religious traditions were worthless, but that a Savior had come from the Jews. In verse 23, Jesus said, but the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship Him. Jesus said that the true worshiper will worship in spirit and in truth. The word spirit is not referring to the Holy Spirit, but is referring to the human spirit. Worship is an internal expression. Worship should never be built on an outward ceremonies or rituals. In our culture, music has become central in worship services. However, music is not worship. It is simply an expression of worship. True worship comes in submitting our hearts to Jesus Christ. Jesus said that we should worship the Father in spirit and in truth. In order for us to worship in spirit, we must agree with the truth found in the Word of God. The Word of God tells us that the truth about Christ, the Word of God shows us our sinful state and points us to a Savior. A true worshiper will worship in spirit and in truth because it is the Father who draws them to do so. Jesus said that He was seeking such people to worship Him. The woman at the well is a beautiful picture of how God pursues after us. It is God who pursues and draws us. Now that we have examined the reason for Christ, the response of Christ, let's now examine the revelation of Christ. Next, we say that God is spirit. This is a classical definition of the nature of God. God is called the invisible God in the Old Testament. God became flesh in the New Testament, become the sacrifice for our sin. Again, we see Jesus say that because God is spirit, we must worship Him in spirit and in truth. Again, Jesus is saying that we are not to conform to rituals or ceremonies as a method of salvation, but we are to stand on the truth of God's Word. Jesus said, I know that the Messiah is coming. He who is called the Christ. When that one comes, he will declare all things to us. We see that she expressed hope that one day the Messiah would one day come to make things right. What we see was this woman knew the truth. She had known the truth. But up until this point, she was not willing to accept the truth. She had a hope that one day there was going to be a Messiah coming who would set things right. Notice what Jesus said. I who speak to you am he. Also notice the woman did not argue with the proclamation of Christ. She did not sit there and say, oh, wait a minute. What did you say? Wait, back up a minute. You're what? No. She did not argue about his deity. She did not argue the fact that who was standing in front of her was God. She did not argue. This shows us the gift of divine revelation. What we see in this text is this woman was given the gift of faith. Why does she not argue about Jesus? Because she was given the faith of God to believe. Today we've examined the circumstances of living water, the communication of living water, the conviction of living water, and the Christ of living water. Listen, we have seen that this woman displayed an openness to the words of Jesus. She revealed that she is concerned about salvation and about the things of God. Jesus simply reveals himself as the supply she needs. This is what he does for the sinner. He doesn't come to you as judge to condemn you. He never condemned this woman. He doesn't come as a bully to force you to come to him. He doesn't come as a buffet to offer you many choices of salvation. He simply comes as the way, the truth, and the life, and offers himself to you as the only way of salvation. What was it that took this woman from being a hardened sinner who was dead to spiritual things and transformed her into a powerful witness for the Lord? It can be summed up in one word. Jesus. Jesus. He makes the difference in any life he touches. Listen, has he touched your life? Has he redeemed you from your sins? Oh, my friends, today you can know the realization of living water.
Thank you for joining us here today at Rekindle Church. My friends, do you need living water? Do you need a change in your life? Maybe you feel like an outcast in society. Maybe you're wondering, man, is anybody ever gonna love me? Well, I'm here to tell you, Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins. Guess what? He died for all the outcasts and all the misfits of the world. That's what he did. And listen, we want to be able to talk to you, be able to help you. And if you want more information about how you can know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, just follow the information at the bottom of the screen. And remember this, I love you, and Jesus does.